Welcome children. Today we continue with our chapter on the Delhi Sultans. This is the second part of the video, and in this video we will learn about the strategies the Delhi Sultans used in order to expand their empire. Or in other words, we can say the ways and methods they adopted to conquer vast areas and establish their rule in India. And this Delhi Sultanate rule lasted for 300 years. Now we will look into the strategies for growth. That is the heading of the chapter. We will look into the strategies, the ways and methods the Delhi Sultan rulers adopted in order to expand the empire. First, we will look into the early rule. We will look in right from Qutbuddin Aibak. What was his strategy, okay, in the early times of the Delhi Sultan rule, and then which were the other sultans who expanded the kingdom, and finally we see during the Tughlaq rule almost the entire India was under the control of the Delhi Sultans. From garrison town to empire. This is the heading given in your textbook. Now we are going to understand how the Delhi Sultanate started from a garrison town to become an empire controlling vast areas. So basically we are going to study right from the beginning, when they started from a small town to becoming an empire. So the expansion of the Delhi Sultanate. So before we go into it, we must understand what is garrison town. So children, what is a garrison town? A garrison town is a fortified settlement with soldiers. So where a group of soldiers live and guard the town, and fortified means it is surrounded by walls. So children, here you can see a picture of the garrison town. You can see how the entire town is fortified with a wall, and everyone is living inside this fortified area, okay, and the soldiers are there who are living along with the people to guard the entire city. So this was called as the garrison town. So when the Delhi Sultanate rule started, they started off with as garrison town. They conquered a city or an area, and fortified it, and all the people lived inside that, and they were guarded by soldiers. Can you see, this is called as a garrison town. So you see children, this is a picture of a garrison town. Just to explain to you better, you can see there were barracks built for the soldiers where they would live. There were other things in the city, and the entire city was fortified with walls all around it, so that it was protected and nobody could enter that city. So this is what in the early rule the Delhi Sultanate rulers did. They made garrison towns. Another important word that you must understand before I go ahead with the chapter, it is hinterland. Now what is hinterland? They are areas which are very, very far away from the main city. They are remote areas, very far away from the sea coast, from the major rivers or from the main cities, and they are totally dependent on the nearby ports and cities for all kinds of goods and services, because they are absolutely far away where nobody can reach, very remote areas. So here you can see a picture of a hinterland which is very far away from the city. Children, let us look into the early rule of the Delhi Sultans, starting from Qutbuddin Aibak in the early 13th century. The Sultans at that time would only conquer a town or a city, and then they would keep their soldiers and army there to guard the city. They would also build a huge wall all around the city, so in order to protect all its people there. And rooms were also constructed for soldiers who would live inside the town with the people there, and this kind of a town was called as a garrison town. Okay, so that's why the heading is from garrison town to an empire. So they started off having garrison towns, and then how they conquered vast areas of India. Once the garrison town was made, the sultans did not have any control over the hinterlands. Now I had explained to you what the hinterlands are, areas which are very far away from the city, and therefore the sultans were dependent on supplies. They had to give food and other things to their people, and they were dependent on what? How will they get it? Because it was all fortified. So How did they get the food and other supplies? Either would trade with the people who lived away from outside the city, or they would either give gifts to the sultans as a tribute, or the other option was to just loot and plunder, just go and forcefully take away things from the people who lived outside the city. But this also was not easy, and the sultans faced many problems. Children, I just mentioned a while ago that the early Delhi sultans would occupy a town and city, and then they would fortify it and keep their army there. That is why it was called a garrison town. They had no control over the hinterlands, that means the remote areas away from the garrison town. Okay, so they had garrison towns in Delhi where the sultan lived, and they also had a garrison town in Bengal and Sindh. Now, so sultan lived in Delhi, whereas the sultan appointed a governor to look after the Sindh garrison town and another governor to look after the Bengal garrison town. Okay, but what were the problems with these garrison towns? Since they didn't have control over the other areas, it was very difficult for them to really look after the other garrison town. It was very far away and communication was not proper. There were no proper roads, so it was difficult at times to go and see what was happening in Sindh and Bengal. Then bad weather at times, there used to be bad weather, extreme cold or heat or rains. They were unable to really look after these garrison towns. Another thing was that there were Mongols who had heard, Mongols from China who had heard about the rich and wealth of India, wanted to come in and attack India to loot and plunder, and they would enter through Afghanistan. Okay, so most of the time they were fighting wars in order to prevent the Mongol invasions into India, because the Delhi sultans wanted to rule. They didn't want any more Mongols coming into India. And then these governors also felt that these sultans, early sultans, are very weak. They are unable to control. So they wanted to assert the independence and break away from the Delhi sultan rule. So there was a constant pressure on the Delhi sultans. And later, Delhi sultans believed that it's no longer a garrison town will help. We must occupy the entire area, including the hinterland. So we see rulers like Ghiyasuddin Balban, Alauddin Khilji, and Muhammad bin Tughlaq. They believed in now occupying the entire vast area of India in order to have a better control. And that is why we see now moving from garrison town to creating an empire, conquering vast areas. Now, just a recap of the problems again, just to, so that it is clear to you. So first problem was controlling the garrison towns. There were garrison towns in Bengal and Sindh, so it was very difficult for the Delhi Sultan who were ruling from Delhi to look after these garrison towns in Bengal and Sindh. As communication was not proper, so it was very difficult for them to really go and see what was happening there. Any small or big thing like a rebellion, war, or even a bad weather would snap the fragile communication route. So if something like this happens, they would be unable to go there. Okay, so this is first problem was of the control. They were unable to control the garrison towns because they were very far off. Now the second problem was of the invasions. Yes, the sultan's authority was challenged because they had to prevent Mongol invasions. The Mongols basically from China were coming through Afghanistan in order to loot and plunder India. Why did they want to loot and plunder India? Because they had heard about the rich and wealth of India. So the constantly the sultan was busy in preventing Mongol invasions, and the governors who were looking after Sindh and Bengal now felt that the sultan was weak, as unable to control, and they also wanted to break away from the Delhi Sultanate empire. Okay, so these were the two basic problems in the early rule of the Delhi sultans. One was they could not control the garrison towns which are far away, and second, they had to fight a lot of wars and prevent Mongol invasions. The later Delhi sultans believed not only being limited to the garrison town, but they believed in expanding their empire and bringing more and more areas under their control. Now, who were these later Delhi sultans? They were Ghiyasuddin Balban, Alauddin Khilji, Muhammad Tughlaq. they believe that now it's time that they get out of the garrison town and occupy more areas. And they broadly did it in two ways. What was their expansion policy? First, along the internal frontier. That means if they were ruling Delhi, they would occupy all the areas which come under Delhi, all the hinterland also. Okay, so first grow that Delhi area, and then also now expand the areas and borders of their kingdom. That means occupying other kingdoms which are there in India and bringing under their control. That means along the external frontiers. So the expansion policies of the later Delhi Sultan was increasing and the internal frontier and also expanding the external frontier. So children, how did they aim to expand the internal frontiers? It was to consolidate the hinterlands of the garrison town. As I told you, they only had a garrison town, fortified it, but the areas, the remote areas outside the garrison town was not under their control. So the first thing was to expanding the internal frontiers, is to consolidate all the hinterlands, okay, so that the area of Delhi would be increased. And then they also believed in expanding their external frontiers. That means to send military expeditions to distant places of the subcontinent, the other kingdoms which are there in India, and bring it under their control. So the later Delhi Sultans expanded in two ways. One was expanding the internal frontiers and also expanding the external frontiers. So children, here you see a map of Alauddin Khilji's campaign on expanding his external frontiers. So you can see he sent his military army to Gujarat, Chittoor, Ranthambore, then even to the south, okay, the fighting wars, and bringing all this area under their control. So this was how they sent their army to control, to occupy all these areas, in fact occupy vast territories of India and bring it under their control. So these were some of the campaigns made by Alauddin Khilji in order to expand the external frontiers. Now let us look into the strategies or the methods adopted by the later Delhi Sultans in order to expand the internal frontiers and external frontiers. Let's look at the internal frontiers and see what was the strategy that they used. So first thing was they cleared up the forest of the land between the Ganga and Yamuna region, which is called the Doab region. Very fertile area because it's on the banks of river Ganga and Yamuna. The land in between them, it has fertile soil. So first thing, they cleared up all the forest and they wanted to encourage agriculture there. And the hunters and gatherers and pastoralists who were living in the forest were asked to move out. Okay, who are pastoralists? Who move around with their cattle in search of food and fodder. So they were all asked to move out from there. Why were they asked to move out? Because they now wanted to give this land, the cleared up land, cleared up forest land, to the peasants and encourage agriculture. So because it was a fertile land, lots of crops could be grown at one time, and they could earn a lot of revenue because they could collect taxes from these farmers, and the farmers also would be happy because it's a very fertile land, lots of crops could be grown, so they would happily pay the taxes. And with the help of the taxes, new fortresses, garrison towns were made. They could deploy more army in order to protect the trade routes, and if the trade routes are protected, they could promote more trade with the nearby kingdoms. Okay, so with the help of this money and inflow coming in, the kingdom is going to prosper. So this was the strategy to expand the internal frontiers. Now, what did they do? What kind of methods they used to expand the external frontiers? First of all, they sent their army to South India, and mainly by two rulers, Alauddin Khilji and Muhammad bin Tughlaq. So this army would go down and fighting with the other kingdoms that were there. They would capture their elephants, horses and slaves. They would also carry away all the precious metals that were found in that area. And it is said that by the end of the Muhammad bin Tughlaq, that was almost 150 years later from when the Delhi Sultan Sultanate period started, the armies had marched over a large part of the subcontinent. The entire subcontinent was under their control. So here, children, is a map where you can see, and after the rule of Muhammad bin Tughlaq, almost entire India is under the control of the Delhi Sultan rulers. Children, with this we come to an end to the second part of the video, and we'll continue with the chapter in my third video, which I will be posting soon. Thank you so much. Please do view and subscribe.